Hello everyone, my name is Raylazor and welcome to Ring of Fates. In this episode, I highly recommend you carry around a few extra Cure Magicites and a bunch of Clear Magicites, because we're heading on over to the Abyssus Forest today. So give me a second to set things up. There we are. And let's rock and roll! So we're gonna head straight out, and Abyssus Forest is very large and lengthy, so there's a bunch of monsters scattered around the place. And this means this video will probably end up a little bit longer. The good news, however, is that we're going to be seeing our favorite Selkie over here getting one hell of a power upgrade, so that's something to keep in mind as we enter the forest immediately. Now, I'm doing a new setup right now for my recording, so I apologize if things go wonky a little bit. Hopefully nothing goes out wrong, but for the most part, we should be just fine. So what I want to do right now is clear out this entire area here before we move on. And you notice that there are four entrances leading on to strange different places. So what we want to go through is the entrance to the right, which is closest to us right now. And then we'll check out the other entrances. But since we need to progress through this right entrance, I'll actually be going to the top two one first, which are actually connected. And with that, I will also mention about our blocked up entrance over to the left as well. There's quite a few entrances around here. Abyssus Forest is very laid out vertically, so there will usually be two floors to each area, something to keep in mind. But if you follow this guide, I will lead you to victory. Or death, because I almost blew up and died there, so gotta keep that in mind. Another thing to note is that if you have a bunch of attack magicites, I recommend using them, because they can be very effective here dealing with bees, so let's see if we can take care of that hive over there. As you can tell in the minimap, we have a few bees hanging out together. So let's clear out this move first before we do anything drastic. There we are. Now, bees are often accompanied with a hive, so let's see if there's a hive over there. It doesn't seem like it, so that's something to mention next time. Bees are very annoying in that they will cause a lot of poison damage to you, so it's better off to just fire off a twin magicite spell on them, and that should pretty much wipe them out just fine. If there is a hive there, I recommend you run straight up against that hive and immediately destroy it before a next wave of bees spawn out. They're annoying, and if you get caught in the center of them, sometimes you end up in a chain of attacks to the point where you will immediately die due to tons and tons of terrible bee stings. Alright, can we get up here? Yes, we can. Doesn't seem like there's very much up here, but as you can tell, there is a blue barrier blocking this area, which is why we can't get at it. And you also notice there's no way of breaking this barrier just yet. So we'll worry about that later. In the meantime, let's look around for some chests before we move on. It's always good to keep fully stocked up on items for Abyssus Forest. But you don't have to worry about buying too many items, because a lot of it will be provided to you through the forest. Of course, the matter of when you get them is the reason why you may want to buy them. Of course, not necessary, as said previously. So it seems like we've almost cleared out this entire area. Once we deal with this moon, we'll head on straight up to the top center, top right. And it looks like we're going to get our power up. So we get the tree shot, and as you would expect, we now fire 3 arrows per shot. This effectively triples our damage output, which is why Selkies are amazing. Aside from their double jump, of course. So let's try this out on some enemies here. We have a seed spitter. So this does a lot more damage, and stun attacks are pretty effective as well, since we get 3 attacks out on them immediately. Your charge attack is even more effective, and if you're afraid of lizardmen, have no fear, because they'll usually die from 2 charged shot attacks, something fairly easy to pull out. Another thing is that you're going to be more accurate, as you would expect, with 3 arrows, or, well, you'll have a higher chance of hitting enemies. Break that chest here, and try not to land and touch too much poison ivy. It's not too big of a deal though, this poison ivy will go away pretty quickly. If I can angle the camera properly, as you have seen earlier, you'll notice it'll pan up top where you'll see a platform up top. That's something we can encounter in a bit, so something to keep in mind. But we probably won't access this in a while. A lot of Abyssus Forest will loop around, which makes it very confusing, and newcomers to the series will often see a lot of trouble that stems from it. So let's zoom in here, fire shot. Get away from this guy, and be careful, because he can fire fire shot. There we go, fire another one. It looks like I missed 2 arrows, which is why it isn't dead yet. And there we go, it's gonna go down. So this is the point in the game where if you're playing as a Selkie, you're going to be using your SP attacks a lot more often. So let's try to hit these guys. Alright, well we got two, not too bad. These are generally pretty easy to kill, but you don't want to fight them individually because you're going to get up into a very, very dangerous spot. So let's just work our way here. I'm more interested in seeing if there's a hive because we definitely don't want to keep any of those around. Seems like we're clear, so let's move on. Check the river for some river monsters. Doesn't seem like there's any. So it looks like we're doing just fine right now. And as you can see, the two entrances lead to each other. So it doesn't matter which one you take, left or right, red or blue, either or they're both colors. I don't know what I'm trying to say with that. Never mind. Over here, we'll see another barrier, which is yellow this time, which we can't access. This is something that we'll be able to deal with in the future once again. So two barriers to keep in mind. If you keep that in mind till the end of the video, then congratulations. But don't let that lower your enjoyment of this video. And if you're not enjoying this video, I have no idea why you're watching it. So let's just avoid these guys. Seed spitters are a little bit annoying, but for the most part, you can interrupt their attacks and spells by simply attacking them. So nothing too much to worry about. These guys are fairly easy. They get annoying in crowds sometimes, but that's pretty much it. So let's wander around here. What do we have here? Some of the entrances you see in Abyssus Forest might not be accessible, as in we don't even see the entrance. Of course, this means it's on a different floor from us, and we'll eventually encounter it. Eventually. So this is one of the floors, for example. This floor leads to nowhere, and you'll notice there's no actual platform here. Well, there's one up there. So this is pretty much the drop-off point for some other place. And this means this entire area right down here is actually useless. Anyways, we cleared out the monster, so we don't have to worry too much about that. So let's move on and head over to the right entrance. And I don't think I'm a fan of keeping this game in full screen, so I'm just going to switch this into a windowed mode real quick. There we are. Just so I don't have to be afraid that the recording stops or something happens. Gotta keep my eye on it, you know? Alright, now this area can get you a lot of magicites if you play it properly by breaking the cobwebs. You don't have to do this whatsoever. I will be doing this just for the sake of completion. So you can skip through all this and run straight to that red entrance over there if you're ever interested in that. In the meantime, let's take care of these enemies on the ground floor. Now there's a few chests scattered around on this top floor right here that we just was on. So that's something to keep in mind if you're looking for some extra items, scrolls, etc. Otherwise, this should be a fairly straightforward area. We got an entrance to the top left here, which I don't believe we can access yet. We'll be able to find out in a second. Let's take care of the seed spitter here. There we are. Okay. So this guy seems accessible, and it is for a different part of the map once again. You can stack magicites in order to get up there, but I wouldn't recommend that because skipping it doesn't actually lead to faster progression. In fact, you'll actually be setting yourself back because you'll have to run backwards, and you'll see why once we get to the so to say boss door of the area. In the meantime, let's just use some charge attacks. I don't know why I decided to switch over to regular, probably because I got used to just mashing the button a lot. There we are. Anything over here? There should be a chest. There is. Gonna get a few more free items. Doesn't seem like we're gonna really need them. We're pretty well stocked up, and you can see, Abyssus Forest is chock full of materials and other things that you may want. As is most levels. Usually you won't really need to buy anything except crafting for armor and weapons. Alright, so far so good. I'll check the top floor after taking care of this Mew and any other ground enemies. And then we can move right on. Another thing to keep in mind is that fire magicites are the only thing effective against cobwebs, I believe. So don't try to use anything else. Make sure you don't waste your fire magicites too quickly. If you're dealing with hives of bees, you can also use blizzard and electric magicites as well. So don't be tempted to using only fire magicites. I just like them because they're fairly abundant, but I will probably switch over if I find that I'm running a little bit low on them. Alright, we seem pretty cleared out for this. Let's just break this web for good fun and use our charge attack on you. There we are. One, and as you can see, serious damage right now. Definitely a huge upgrade for the Selkies. So if you've been feeling a little bit underpowered, you might enjoy this level quite a bit. There we are, and alright, one sitting right in the dead center of Ivy. The good news is that the Ivy doesn't really create a long-lasting poison effect. It usually lasts one tick compared to the bees, which will last like, probably a good 10-15 seconds or so. Let's crack open this web and move straight on through then. Alright, so we got another area pretty much completely covered in Ivy, monsters, and chests. So it's a little bit dull near the start, but I don't know, things come together near the end of Abyssus Forest, which is pretty interesting. We got a hive over here, and since we have a surplus of blizzard magicites, let's switch over to these real quick. Inch our way towards the bees, just ever so slightly, there we are. Cast our spell. We didn't get the fourth one, and now we've gotten poison, so this is a problem. Which makes it harder to hit the hive, which means there's another set of bees to come out. Let's back off for a bit and make sure that our poison can clear out. If you're not interested in waiting out this, you can always use a clear magicite in order to get rid of the status effect immediately. I'm not doing this because I would have to reach out with my mouse, and I'm just not feeling that right now, so let's see if we can get all four here. There we go, and we managed to hit the hive right away as well, so we won't have to worry about hitting the hive, and there won't be anything else to spawn out. We got fire barrels here, which aren't very important. Let's go check out this bottom floor first. Want to clear out all the bottom floors before we move on ahead, and it seems like this angle is very strange, but we should be just fine here. Move on over to the right side, we got a little bit of monster hanging out here as well. A lot of Abyssus Forest is designed to be abysses, so it's very large, spacious in general, but it can certainly get annoying. I remember being lost in this specific area on my first playthrough, and I ended up just wandering in circles for hours trying to use the minimap and having it not help me because, you know, the minimap's 2D, not exactly 3D. There we go. Take care of you, Mr. Lizard Man. And let's switch on over to our elixir just so we can get some SP back in our system. And we'll switch over to our clear magicite as well just so we have even distribution, so to say. Alright, let's deal with these seed spitters and move on. As you can see, the spell managed to get interrupted. Pretty good. However, their spells, if they do manage to cast them, are fairly annoying. So I believe they can cast gravity, which makes it so you're unable to jump, which makes it pretty hard to maneuver across and against enemies, as well as slow, which makes it nearly impossible to do anything because you're just at a snail's pace. Very annoying. Alright, let's break this chest open. Now obviously we are supposed to be using this target left in order to move this thing around. Of course, it's not necessary since we're a Selkie. So let's just deal with you guys. A little bit annoying here because the guy from the adjacent cell is able to actually hit you, as you can see right there. But it's pretty good since you're able to shoot through these walls, so you won't have to worry too much about it. A glitch I'm completely fine with performing since these guys are pretty annoying with their spell casting to begin with, so we'll just be doing that. Obviously, hitting the enemy with three arrows is a lot more effective than one, but we've been dealing with one for like, what, the past four videos? We should be fine if we do it for another video. There we are. Hop, hop. Okay, we got a hive going on over there, so I want to be a little bit cautious. Let's go in here with a charge attack and then break the barrels up above, collect the items and materials in there before we move on ahead. There we are. Okay. And what are we going to get? We got a black band of strength, which is great. This allows us to get a power ring, I believe. But because we're able to add attachments to it, we can add extra abilities to it as well. Something to keep in mind. Alright, let's give Blizzard another go. And we'll take care of you since you're so close up here. And I don't know why you're doing this, but sure, whatever. Let's just... Okay, the items aren't very helpful, and falling into Ivy isn't as helpful either. Can I shoot and hit things through this wall? I can, but can I hit the hive? This is very annoying right now, actually. I think I can hit the hive, so let's do this for now. Definitely want to get rid of that hive first. The most important thing, really. These bees are never non-stop spawning, excuse me. And I don't believe you get EXP after a while, so it's not worth it to attempt to farm them. And even if you do get EXP from them, it's usually not a large sum, so it's not really worth it to attempt to farm these guys. You're better off just doing a speed run through of it, fighting bosses, going to the Shadowlands once we cover that in the future and whatnot. So in the meantime, let's just focus on what we have on our plate right now, which is a pile of bees. Very annoying. Maybe they're wasps? I have no idea. Alright, we have a lizard man on the loose right here. There we are. Cool, let's wander away from you and just switch to our clear magic site. Use this if we can. There we are, cleared it up. I was worried that I would switch over to the clear magic site and just have it pretty much clear up and have me just switch back again. Very annoying when you're just moving your mouse left and right. While you're trying to play with a controller simultaneously. The button view is very important with a DS game, I feel. There we go, got a fury weapon. And something to keep in mind is that there are three weapons you can get from Abyssus Forest, I believe. And I will probably be choosing the plain option, but I'll show you the description for the other ones as well, of course. Unfortunately, I probably won't be able to show the in-game motto of it because, you know, when you're standing in town, you don't exactly get to show off your motto for the weapon. Alright, I think this area is pretty much cleared out, so let's not dilly-dally any longer and move on ahead. Alright, so this is the point where I believe you're able to meet Nash in the story mode playthrough. Something to keep in mind, but of course since we're a Selkie, we can not worry about any of that and just deal with that one pesky carny flower, I believe? I'm not sure what you guys call these, but one of these flowers. Let's take care of you. In a different lifetime, you destroyed Nash's leg or something. I don't remember. You put a real bad Nash into it. Oh, okay. You gotta entertain yourselves when you're recording these things, you know? Alright, do we have anything else around here? Doesn't seem like it, so let's break this barrel. More surplus supplies that we don't really need. So let's move right on ahead then. There are different ways to tackle on these vertical based areas. So some areas will just have you pretty much wipe out the whole area first in order to be the most effective. And there are some where you should be moving up layer by layer in order to get things done. And there's the mix and match will make it a little bit annoying to deal with Abyssus Forest, but I will show you. Don't you worry. Alright. Anything else over here in this little corner here? Doesn't seem like it because we got a barrel from that, so let's move on ahead. I'm a little bit low on SP, so we might as well recharge right now, and I'm feeling like I have a loss. I'm at a loss for words right now. Alright, let's go. Let's activate this target switch, and this will start moving this platform as you would expect. And this is where things begin to get interesting, where things start to crisscross and branch out, and this is probably where people get confused if they're playing anything but a Selkie. Selkies can get confused pretty quickly since our double jump ability lets us navigate past things that we're not really supposed to. Another thing to note is that Abyssus Forest is extremely cruel to any other races but Selkies. There are areas that you can't access without extreme effort unless you're a Selkie in Abyssus Forest. I don't know why it's not fixed out, but we'll definitely be showing those because I find them fairly interesting. Right now we're checking the bottom of the area, and here you'll also see a platform. Of course you can go for the platform from up top, but this will yield us an attack boost. There we are. We can jump up here, but I don't think I want to do that just yet since we have a rope to go through. And I feel that it's probably necessary to address the crossroads that we have ahead of us, so let's double jump here and double jump. Okay, not there I guess. There we go, let's just go from the start bit. Alright, we have a tightrope. You can, as usual, just hop on the top of it and just run right straight through if you're feeling speedy. Now this place will lead you towards the boss room, but you don't want to go here just yet, because one of the requirements has you go over to this other side first. So we're going to branch off and do this right optional side first, just so we don't have to come back to it afterwards and do a bunch of backtracking. So let's take care of you. I don't want to face that target in case the platform starts moving. There we are. Hit it and let's go. Now there's another chest up ahead and I'm going to crack it open for the sake of it, but this means we're going to have to wait for the platform a little bit longer. Unless I can pull off a jump over there. You know what, I'll pass on now. I'm sure this is a means to move a little bit faster in Abyssus Forest, but if you're looking to move fast, you probably won't want to do this pit stop to begin with. So that's something to keep in mind. You might be able to double jump over there. If you're any other race, I'm sorry once again, because this area is definitely very cruel to your race. I'm very sorry. A few sorry for Lotis who are vertically challenged. I feel sorry for myself in real life because I'm a short, tiny person sitting in front of a computer talking about video games. Yeah! Alright, so this place should lead us to one of those items we're looking for. Yes, it is. So let's take care of this flower first. There we are, got our level 16. Great. Now watch what happens when I hit this target. You'll see that we activate one of four of these yellow palm tree looking things. Basically, you need to activate four in order to get it to float. So that's the only palm tree that's sitting off in this optional area. You can basically go back to the main road if you want now, but I'm going to stick it a little longer because we have two things to check out. One which is an area that is pretty much exclusive to Selkies, and then a chest on our way back. So let's go on over here. And we're back up to the top where you'll notice where that two entrance is, near at the bottom side of the screen, bottom left of the minimap. We've cleared out this area so we won't have to worry about that. These first few jumps, as you can tell, aren't too bad yet. And the monsters we have on the bridge and stuff, it really doesn't seem like a very big deal yet. I can assure you, it is. But first of all, we need to take care of these seed spitters before we can move on. Simply because I don't want to try to jump across them, fall off, and have to do a ton of backtracking. It's kind of a risk already to be going this way. Now, if we talk to this sign right here, there are more footholds beyond here, Coupeau. So this first jump already expects you to have the double jump ability. This entire thing looks very strange with its like circles and little holes cut off the platform. No idea what's going on here. We're hopping here again, a bunch of blind leap of faiths. Presuming you've never done this before. Strange platform navigation, and it leads you to a very strange area. Like, where am I even? There we are. Now if we drop down here, make sure you land on this platform and stay on it after you collect this item. You'll get a gemstone, a random gemstone. Something that you can add to your crafting in order to improve it. And we're just going to double jump back up here. If you're any other race, one, I'm not really sure why you managed to get over here or how. But two, you're going to have to do a lot of backtracking back to where you once were. So let's go back and move on. Now this was very strange because when I was doing my test playthrough, I actually did the test playthrough as a Uke, which is sitting at like level 99 and whatnot. I was very confused why this area wasn't patched up for the other classes. I tried drawing out all the little tiles thinking that this was like something that was written in Japanese kanji or something. I got nothing. It's just a very strange area designed for Selkies for some reason. Maybe there's some sort of like Easter egg thing going on behind it, but I have no idea, frankly. Anyways, that's pretty much this area. A great place to pit stop real quick for a quick gemstone. But otherwise, we can move on, sort of. It's a little bit annoying waiting for these targets to bounce back up, but hey, what can you do? Alright, come on. Waiting. There we are. Alright, one more. Come on. Just so we can get out of that chest before we wait for you again. Another thing to note that a majority of Abyssus Forest's confusion, so to say, how maze-like it is caused by the fact that there is more backtracking in it. I presume this is left over for story mode, and I'll get to that in a little bit later. Now, if you're really impatient for the platform above, you can actually try to go for that platform right below us right here, which I'm going to try to do and fail miserably. Great, now I'm in the middle of nowhere. Let's run all the way back and catch that platform and stuff. Did I kill these guys before already? I don't think I did. Well, we might as well do that now then, because I don't want to lose out on EXP. Because playing the final boss as one character sounds scary. Alright, that's one. Let's go in for a charge attack. There we are. So far, so good. Alright. And there we go. I'm very strict about my consistency with getting EXP is because when I'm doing my test recording, I also play it on a Selkie aside from just a Uke. Not this Selkie in particular, but rather the Selkie on my DS. And this lets me confirm whether something might be an emulation problem or not. Check on certain facts myself, despite the fact that there's a wiki out there. That's pretty good actually, so if you're not a fan of audio content, there's always a wiki out there for you, but I'm sure you already knew that. Alright, let's move on. Break this chest open, gonna get another scroll. Band of Strength, I'm always going to welcome that. Anyways, by being able to kill every single monster, you keep the level ups consistent, so I know exactly what skills I'll get in a certain video, and I can use that as a talking point, which is great for me. Another thing to note out of the blue is that I don't plan on changing this hair color. Blonde is a fine look. Redhead, blonde, I believe you can get green hair or blue hair. I don't really see the purpose of that because, I don't know, that doesn't always fit the costume. Natural hair colors are usually the best unless you're able to control everything. I don't feel like fighting you, so let's just hop right on up here and move on. There we are. Ooh, okay, getting a little jittery here. Alright. Now we can move finally back into progress, where we can activate the other three yellow palm tree things, but first a save point. We can save right here, there's a Moogle behind the tree right here, hello, and we're gonna get a commemorative stamp, fantastic, there's one, alright, and there are two chests in the save zone which contain health items and other things that you may need on your journey. As you can tell, Selkie probably doesn't need them, but we'll crack the chest open just for good fun. There's the other one, let's crack you open, and we're gonna get a bunch of clear magicites, I guess? Sure. Let's go. Alright, lucky us, this next palm tree is going to be activated just by lowering ourselves down to the floor we need to go to. And this floor is covered in monsters as well, which is something that we will take care about right now. Because we have to do a lot more later on, so I wouldn't want to backtrack over here, kill all the monsters before fighting the boss. That's not tense enough. So while it's still relatively low, let's take care of these monsters while we still can, shall we? I don't believe there's any chest on the ground. I might be wrong. I believe there's one nearby the palm tree platform, so that's something to keep in mind. And we'll talk about that a little bit, actually very soon. Here we go. Now, you'll notice that there is a target here. Activating this will activate one of the palm trees, but that is something I don't want to do just yet. I want to leave that one specifically for last, but it seems like I'm not going to get to do that. The reason why I like leaving it for last is that way I'm able to jump onto the platform and ride it up without waiting for it to go up and back down due to the cutscene. Unfortunately, this means we're going to have to wait a little bit longer because of it. Oh well. On the bright side, Abyssus Forest has very straightforward objectives once you get to know it, so doing a speedrun of this won't be the fastest thing ever, but it will also be the cleanest way to go through. So if you're playing as a different class from a Selkie, I would highly encourage that if you really need to, just go fast forward all the way to my speedrun part of it, which will probably be like, I don't know, a good 10-15 minutes from now, maybe 20. Let's hop into this first area right here, and this will lead us to the bottom floor of, if I can get on this platform without bees attacking me, I believe this will lead us to the crossroads. Let's see here. There we are, as you can tell. Ah, okay, hold on. I'm gonna show this. I don't care if this takes too long. Hold on. We need to show this. I got a little too eager there. There we are. As you can see, there's the target platform. This is the whole area below it. It's pretty much covered in bees, a few enemies here and there, mainly bees. I don't like bees. If there was one area I would skip this area, but we must not for the sake of consistency, so let's take care of these bees. Okay, that was not very effective. It looks like these bees are pretty spread out, so I'm just gonna work on the hive right now because I really don't want more bees. That's the whole idea, bee control this, that. Please don't kill bees in real life, by the way. They're sort of in trouble. No good. Alright, so far so good. So this is a way for you to get back up in case you fall off, as you would expect. But otherwise, this bottom floor here is actually pretty dull. So, not too much to worry about. Move over here. Activate the spell. There we go. Combine. And activate. And let's immediately work on this hive, despite the fact that there's one bee here. There we are. and we can prevent another extra 3 or 4 bees from spawning. Fantastic. Alright, there's still a pile over at the bottom, and once we take care of that, we'll move back up to the top area, or rather, back to the left area where we're supposed to go. Silly me, I'm getting my left and rights and my ups and downs confused. Probably because this place is Abyssus Forest. Alright, come on. Right, these are bees. They will keep respawning. Let's just sneak the hive real quick while we still can. There we are. And bees themselves are generally weak, so don't worry about like just going up against them and just smashing their face in with a nice sword or something. Apparently the people in Ring of Fates are very good with their accuracy, so give them props for that. Anyways, let's backtrack now because this is our first backtrack area and there's, I believe, 2 more to go through. So don't worry, if you're into backtracking, there's going to be tons of it. And I'm sure no one here wants the backtracking, but nonetheless, we keep marching on. Now I could double jump right up here right now and just skip this entire area, I really could. But it's generally easier to just take things out one by one, following the pathway set off for us. So we won't be hopping up here because we're checking out the whole area. We might as well make it a little bit more consistent for us. So there's a platform, nothing to worry about. Moving back onto a second floor, so let's deal with this lizard man. Oh, it looks like there's 2. I believe there's like 3 or 4 lined up, so if you're not a particular fan of lizard men, now is a fantastic time to play around with your charge attack. Something that I would definitely do simply because it minimizes the amount of time I need to spend getting close to this thing in order to hit it. Since Selkies are fairly slow at points, it's always good to have a nice charge attack ready for you. Okay, let's just now get right on around. There we go, that's 1. Gonna get shot with a fireball. Wait, navigate around again. Hello, and we're gonna take you out just fine. Alright. Now is a great time to recharge your SP. There we are. We'll use some clear magicites as well. And I think I want to use a potion as well, since we're a little bit low on health. Not too bad though, 70 health, but we already have a surplus of medical supplies, so I see no reason why not to. Alright, is there anything else here? No, it doesn't seem like it, so now is the time to crawl up. Alright. More bees, I want to deal with the move first. It doesn't matter if I hit the bees because obviously these darn things will probably respawn. Not exactly a fan of that, but hey. I guess this is what happens when you have a ton of bees. I'm gonna do this from long range since I don't think I want to get too close to these bees. There we are. I'm pretty sure the most like said word for this episode at least will probably be bees. The word probably, the word like, or something like where I'm busy trying to figure out what to say. Or empty silence. You know, that could also be a potential problem. Alright. So far so good. Another lizard man to deal with, so let's just do that. There we go. Sometimes we get hit by them. Watch your health because these guys hit quite a bit to Selkies. As usual, we have a fairly low pool of health, something to definitely always keep in mind. Alright. Anything else around here? There's a pathway to the left there. Not really sure what's going on with that. Actually, never mind. I think I know exactly what's going on with that. So we are going to head over there first. So you can tell at this point it's split into 2 paths. The path that I am facing right now with Selkie is the path you want to go. The path I'm facing right now and the path I'm walking to is the path we're going to need to go to complete this whole area. Of course, I do want to keep emphasizing that you don't need to clear out this whole area. I am doing this purely for EXP and items, so I have a quick surplus. Anyways, we're in this area, which is basically areas for backtracking once more. Clear out the whole area, basically, and then we'll be pretty much good to go to activate those 2 barriers. So let's work on killing these enemies and end up with a bunch of dull commentary because I don't really know what else to say. Should I talk about myself? Is that too narcissistic? I am talking to myself right now to begin with, expecting people to watch it, so I guess that is the ultimate form of narcissism. To think you're important. It's okay, you are important. A quick note is that this beehive up here, you'll probably want to hop up here and destroy it first instead of waiting for the bees to spawn in. Of course, the bees will still spawn in, so just something to keep in mind as you can see right here. There will always be one set of bees that spawn, and then if the hive is still around, that's where the extra bees will come in. Or the backup bees? This is starting to sound like a band. And my voice is starting to crack, so we got a yellow berry over here, and let's continue taking care of these enemies, since I don't want to relinquish that berry just yet. I'll worry about that later. I'm not sure if relinquish is even the right word for a barrier, but hey, don't worry about that. Anything in these crooks and nannies? Doesn't seem like it. So far, so good. Alright. Another lizard? Okay, sure. Why not? As you can see, I'm pretty much killing my SP right now. I'm actually running on zero, so switch back on over. I say we should use two elixirs because, well, we have two right in front of us, so we might as well restock a little bit. There we are. And we'll switch to Thunder Magicite since we're running a little bit low on Blizzard Magicites. There we are. I wanted to say Cold Magicites because that sounded right to me for that moment. I'm actually very tired right now, but don't worry about it. It's only 8:47 a.m. and I have not slept last night. So my voice isn't doing too good here, and I don't know if my brain is doing the best for commentary, but I will try my best because you don't always get the most optimal time to record. Obviously, I'm a hobbyist, so I don't have this like some sort of 8 hours of empty silence for myself to record things. Often just dealing with a lot of buzzing noise, so that's something to keep in mind. Alright, so we've cleared out that bottom side pretty much. Let's take care of these seed spitters. And I guess a lizard man. Is this all we're going to deal with for enemies for a little bit? Because this is getting a little bit tiring. There we go. Walk in, run around, charge. Gonna want to hit you with a charge attack, lizard, because these seed spitters are a cakewalk. There we are, and let's grab all of this stuff. Probably gonna become really rich at the end of this video because of all the stuff that's lying around. Oops, wrong thing. Switch over to my ether. There we are. Activate those as well. And let's break open these two chests, which we're going to get an icy weapon and a thunderous weapon. Okay, so I got that wrong. We aren't getting three weapons in this area. We're getting four. So I presume one for each of the attack magicites and then one default one. Spoiler alert, we're going for the one default one. I'm sorry if you're interested in elemental thingamabobs, but they're really not that effective. Alright, so let's deal with that last enemy that's apparently taunting me up there. There we are. Hop, hop, and where are you? There you are. Oh no, there's a hive here too. Right, I forgot about this one. Very annoying. Let's back up for a second. Switch over to our lightning magic sights. Thunder ones if you want to get specific, but I don't think that's the right word. And we'll work on this hive before we kill that seed spitter. If I can jump, there we are. Okay. Quite a crowd. Lots of items on the floor right now. Probably makes it a very hard place to navigate through or trying to attack people. The good news is that most of my pockets are full, so I won't have to experience the constant slowdown every time I try to pick something up. Alright, one chest. Is this all? I think this is pretty much it. So let's hop back down and go to those two locked up barriers. Now, it feels like I said... Okay, hold on. We got another thing to deal with here. Don't mind me. Alright, here we go. Speed Spitter. So, mentioned yourself earlier. I'm not a fan of the whole idea of you have to go purposely find those monsters to spawn. A huge waste of time. Alright, let's break this blue barrier right here. And this will reveal our first area that we got into at the start of this forest, which was covered with a blue barricade. And if we move over here, you'll notice that this barricade is yellow. So I think you know what this is. As you would expect, I would expect that much from you, you brainy, smart viewers of you. Yes, sirree. I am having trouble coming up with words. Anyways, this entire area was backtracked, and as you can tell, this eats up a large amount of time. So we're sitting at like 40 minutes now. I'm reiterating things, and as you can tell with the constant like similar topics, there's not that much in Abyssus Forest as you might think, so don't get intimidated by it. It's straightforward in its own regards, I think. And I think I want to use my tribal ability here. Never mind, because I just got gravitated, so let's just switch over to our cure magicite here. And fire just slow shots at these guys, because I'm really not feeling it right now. Think of this like a shooting range. You can't get over to the targets. You can, but you're gonna be put in a very strange spot. Instead, let's just fire over the barricade and take care of these guys. Alright, am I even hitting the hive? Alright, let's fix that because I don't want to deal with that hive all day. There we go. Come on. 1, 2, 3, 4. I just want you to go away, please. Ugh. Almost there, I think. Come on. I really hate the auto-aiming in this game. It makes it a little bit more difficult to aim for a very specific target. There we are. Finally got rid of that. Alright, let's clear this area out. Okay, what else do we have left? A pile of bees that I'm probably not going to interrupt. And for the most part, I think we are good to go. Alright, let's break this chest open, deal with what is to be assumed as two moos, and then move on to our final palm tree, I guess, to activate. I often call them umbrellas accidentally. I'm not too sure why. I guess it's sort of shaped like an umbrella, but when you take a good close look at them, you can tell those things weren't meant to be umbrellas. They're not very good ones. Alright, let's step on these platforms and our final target. Let's break this open and activate the platform. And as you can see, it immediately goes up, which is why we need to wait for it to float back down and float back up. And this is the reason why I wanted to save this switch over here for last. So let's hop onto this platform. And this next boss fight will start very quickly and... Oh, come on. This next boss fight will start off very intensively, so I'll try my best to explain this as quick as possible without messing myself up because it's a little annoying. Make sure you have a bunch of cure or healing items at this point. Since I have my potions and my cure magicites maxed out, I think I'll be fine. If not, I recommend you go around and look for some extra cure magicites. Anyways, let's head on in. Alright, so we're dealing with a giant plant here, and you'll see these two little buds coming out of the ground. In order to open up the plant, you're going to need to kill both of these buds, unless you're a Selkie or very ingenious. What you can also do is immediately jump on top of the crystal, and this will automatically lead it to open its mouth. So that way we can completely avoid the attacks of those two plants. Another thing to mention is that it's completely fine to be poisoned in this fight. The biggest goal right now is to focus on standing on this crystal and just bearing the attacks. Except for that spinning one. That spinning attack is probably the most dangerous attack out of them all. When it spins, it's able to launch you off the ground, and by this, one of the buds is able to actually chain combo attack you, so you can lose upwards to almost all of your health very quickly. Make sure to heal often when you're low on health because of these spinning attacks, and know you cannot avoid them by double jumping, even to the full extent of it. So you usually will have to jump right on off in order to avoid getting hit, and this is better off than actually just taking the hit because, well, you'll get knocked off, get hit by another thing, and usually you'll end up on the ground. So we got lucky there because we landed on its head without getting hit, and we managed to land on our feet by hitting the jump button in time. So let's end up right back on top. You'll notice the plant closes its mouth and opens once again because we are, of course, standing on the top of it. And you can just see that's one of those combos that gets very dangerous. And because of the giant AoE feud of its spinning attack, these things can be very dangerous. As you can tell, I'm already having trouble trying to get close to this enemy. Another thing to keep in mind is to stay in the center of the battlefield because there's bees all around the place, and this makes it so much harder. Get away from me, leave me alone, I'm trying to heal and get an attack. Stop using your stupid spinning attack. This is so frustrating right now. Oh my god. Oh, this is certainly one of the most annoying boss fights, despite the fact that Abyssus Forest is generally fairly easy. The good news, however, is that if you get a nice luck streak where it's constantly using this poison attack, you won't have to worry too much about it. And if you have a clear magicite on hand, you can do a lot of damage very quickly. Once again, stay away from the edges of this battlefield. That's where the real danger is. Standing in the center is actually the least dangerous area because the outside area has a bunch of buds that can attack you. and further outside are a bunch of bees which can help chain combo. While bees don't do very much damage, I've told you previously that they can easily stun lock you, and that leaves those buds and this big plant right here to be a very big meanie to you. Don't worry about the other enemies once you've defeated the boss because they'll automatically despawn, so just focus on this boss and you should be just fine, except when you're me where I'm sitting at 36 points of health. Wow, that's Selkie pride, am I right? Ooh, I wish my health bar was a little bit longer. Like 50%. Alright, get on this guy, let's finish this boss before it's too late. Just ride out the poison, no big deal, we can do this. Here we are, and we've done it. There we go, and we've been cured magically from our clear poison as well. And we get to pick up quite a few scrolls here and there, lovely. Alright, so I'm thinking I will probably want to head to town right away. Simply because I would like this boss fight to be easier since it still poses a threat to me. So let's go buy and craft some things and see what we can do over on that end. And let's save too. Let's head on over to Rebena Te Ra then. And we'll talk to those two new NPCs as well. Two new NPCs, so to say. Two new sets of dialogue. So let's go over here. You notice that these two kids will have their big sis show up again. And you want to talk to the big sis once after talking to the kids, and then talking to the kids again. I'll just show you. Oh no, she's wicked mad this time. Her face looks like monsters at war. Alright, and we have got this low T right here.
Humana, I feel like a frog frozen in fear by the steady stare of a snake.
Where the heck have you two been? I turned around and you were gone. I was worried sick and wasted my time looking all over for you. Some weird bird chased me up on Mount Val and a huge plant came after me in the woods. Sheesh.
Oh, sorry. We should have realized you might get worried.
So sorry, shish.
Sis really does have a heart. In spite of her fright, her big concern was that we were okay.
We should apologize to her. This might take a while.
Say, why don't I make us a nice meal? I picked up some food while I was out looking for you two. Purple mushrooms, a plant that says kupo kupo. They may not look good, but they'll taste fine. It's been too long since we have done some real cooking. How about it?
Great idea, but let us do it. You must be exhausted, so you just kick back and take it easy.
That's right, shish. Your blood pressure's high as it is. We can't have you risk having a stroke.
Really? How sweet. Okay, you're on. I'll relax for once and leave the work to you.
I'm glad to see that they're maturing, concerning the feelings of others. They say that traveling matures a person. In that sense, the latest incident might have been not so bad. Might have not been so bad. Ugh.
We're back to doing the daily struggles of trying to keep Sis's questionable cooking down. I feel like it builds character, but I think I'll be kinder to others when I'm older because of it.
Alright, there you go. And the low tea?
I still don't understand how she can taste that swill and say it's delicious. Senses simply are beyond my comprehension.
Oh my god, that's like... Ugh. Alright, well, that's pretty much the end of this little group of shenanigans.
Is your face green?
Oh, that's your bow tie. Silly me. We have another Selkie hanging out over here right now. So let's talk to these two.
I thought I'd never get back.
Why? Where were you?
Oh, I went to Abyssus Forest and got lost.
Shh, you're an embarrassment to Selkies everywhere.
I can't help it. When you live in the city your whole life, your instincts are bound to get a bit dull.
What a total lame excuse. My Selkie instincts have always been as sharp as they've always been.
Were they in peak form when you were dragging back that load of rocks you thought were bird eggs?
How did you... Maybe I underestimated your instincts.
That Selkie chick, I'll show her who's sharp.
And if we talk to her, we will reveal the true truth of the Selkie.
That nitwit's escapades may make it to the town grapevine... Oh my god.
That nitwick's escapades make it to the town's grapevine within minutes. I found out as soon as I got back. Well, I guess that's probably because you're talking to a bunch of strangers about it. That's certainly one thing to cause an effect, I suppose.
Alright, that's pretty much all the NPCs we need to talk to, so let's go to Chappie and work on, I don't know, making something, shall we? Alright, what do we have here? Let's sort by our weapons. And it looks like we have a thunderous weapon, which doesn't fit us, so we don't need to worry about that. An icy weapon, a fury weapon, and a warrior's weapon. So, I'll see if I can make all three, which will allow me to flash the description up on screen. So let's do that. We'll work on the warrior's weapon first. Actually, before we even do any of that, let's go into our buy and buy some materials because a bunch of gemstones are now available. And you can use these to improve your weapons. So as a Selkie, I recommend you focus on ruby gemstones and amethyst gemstones. Amethyst gemstones allow you to improve your tribal and charge attacks, while a ruby gemstone will increase your overall attack power. Something to keep in mind. We should also buy some move for. Actually, we're sitting at 14. We'll be fine. Now let's go into our scrolls real quick, because you can actually use these petite gems in order to refine them into better ones. But it doesn't seem like we have those scrolls around here yet, so we won't have to worry about that for now. In the meantime, let's make a warrior's weapon. So I'm going to put a ruby on this because I'm looking for 4 attack power, as you can tell. And we're going to get a war bow with 2 attack powers, so I'm pretty happy about that. Let's equip it. And now we have a fury weapon and an icy weapon, so let's make those as well. These descriptions might be a little bit delayed since they show up on screen every 5 seconds. And we got a flame bow now. There we are. We won't be equipping this one. And now we can make an icy weapon, which will get us a frost bow, which we will also not be using. So what's the difference between the steel weapon, the fury weapon, and the thunderous weapon? The steel weapon provides an overall greater chance of getting general damage. The fury weapon will give you crimson essence, which will make your fire magicite attacks much more effective. The icy weapon will improve your your blizzard magicite attacks, and I can only presume that the thunderous weapon will improve your thunder attacks. That was a whole boatload to say. We also have dragon-like helms, which are generally meant for warriors and the such. We have the magic headwear, which is for black mages, I believe. And there is something out there, which will match the white mage's helm for people who like being white mages. And we also got cute kitty hat, if you ever want that. Of course, there's a ton of stuff here, and I'm gonna try to find these set items later. But for the meantime, I think we're gonna go for the dragon-like armor. 1 tortoise shell and 2 iron. And 1 iron and... Okay, so that will work out just fine. We're going to put rubies on these ones as well, because hopefully I'll be able to get some extra attack. And we're not. Dragoon lure will make it so our area attacks are much more effective, something to keep in mind. And while I'm tempted to just keep my old equipment, we certainly do need a defense upgrade. So, give me some attack? Alright, we got a little bit. That's not too bad. And it's gonna improve our abilities by a little bit. Our leveled equipment will increase your attack power by much more, as you would expect. And let's make a band of strength. So we already have a power ring, but we can definitely go for a better one. We'll put an amethyst on this one. Let's see what we can get. So we're going to get an attack boost, again. That looks pretty good, so let's use that. Not really into the dragoon lore thing, but I'm sure that will work out just fine. So that is our set. Let's go to the lovely town center and show this off. Then we'll move on over to the Mugo store, do a mission, and then finally complete our speedrun of the thing. So as you can tell, dragoon salad makes you look pretty cool. Look like a dragon, or a hydra, or a fish. Something in between, you're all purple and stuff. It's pretty neat. But generally, it looks pretty much the same. You can tell with the chest plate and stuff that that part is generally usually recycled. Anyways, let's head on over to the Mog shop and do our thing. Alright, what do you have for us? We have 2 blizzard pockets and a fire pocket so far. That's pretty good. Always good to carry a bunch of those around. I would hope for some ether pockets. Looks like we're not gonna get those, but it's not too bad since we got a clear pocket and 3 potion pouch pockets, so I don't think we'll have to worry too much about healing items. Now, let's go and move on to doing the quest. I am very sorry if my voice sounds very different right now because I can feel it getting sandy, which makes me worry that my voice isn't the best right now, but well, this is what happens when you talk a lot. So good of you to come, audacious adventurer. What will it be today? Something short, please, because I'm really tired. Let's give... firefighters a go. So this looks like a three-stage carry a water jug. Throw that on fires. And, you know, I don't know. Let's just do this. Ah, you have come just at the right moment, friend. How shall I begin to describe the series of misfortunes that have befallen our land of late? I've said enough. You should go take a look for yourself. Great. Oh, I suppose you'd prefer some more background information, hmm? If you insist, but I'll only explain it once, so pay attention. Flames, fires, and conflagrations. It could be the work of monsters or carelessness of commoners. Although the cause of fires is unclear, the sudden and frequent occurrence is quite evident. What we need you to do is hustle from one fire to the next, tossing water jars to quell the flames. Regrettably, the number of water jars is limited, so I recommend mindful and miserly use of them. Oh, fearless firefighters, I expect nothing less than excellence in your execution of duties. So this will basically allow us to head back to the villa and other little rooms. I presume there's a certain few careless residents, commoners around here. Maybe a certain Lady Illyria who forgot to turn off the stove when she went to go bathe Yuri. Yeah, forever, never coming back. Isn't that right? Could at least turn off the heat. I bet you're like just cooking mush now. An interesting thing in a tavern setting is that a lot of the food is basically cooked non-stop and new food is added in over time. So it's basically a mushy congregate, the trail mix of soups, and this is something that happens in back then in taverns. So maybe this is what Illyria is going on. Maybe they actually didn't do very much with the cooking. You're just throwing fish in there once in a while. Anyways, we complete our first stage, not too much to worry about. Looks like we're moving off into Alhanalem's and Meef's? Yeah, Meef's place of chilling altars. And it looks like I messed up a water jug, so that's something to be careful about. Well, I know this is like a blatant recycle of items, basically. I actually do enjoy the whole idea of like seeing commoners get their stuff lit on fire, and you know that like your good old family in the story mode is still just basically a bunch of silly gooses at the end of the day. This goblin is going to make things a little bit annoying since I definitely don't want to accidentally destroy any of the jugs. I don't know if that's even possible, but let's be mindful here and just do jump attacks on you if I can. Very strange place, and as you can tell, there's no time limit, so if you really want to take your time to bowl the perfect shot in order to quell the flames, go for it. In the meantime, I'm going to get rid of this cherry before it causes me any grief. Alright, and that should land a perfect strike. There we are, perfect. Well done, well done. Run more. This reminds me of curling. I presume most of you don't know what curling is. Let me tell you about curling, because I'm running out of things to talk about, frankly. These videos are getting longer, but I'm running out of things to talk about because all I'm doing is, you know, killing monsters. Curling is a Canadian sport, where we basically roll a bunch of hardcore heavy-duty donuts on ice and yell at people to scrub the ice as hard as they can. And the goal is to land a donut at the center. It's basically a game of throwing donuts and shouting at the person, "Scrub harder! Scrub harder!" Because, you know, you want it to slip right into the right spot. Something to keep in mind. There you go. Canadians were weird. We also play lacrosse, which is basically an excuse to hit each other with giant sticks. Canada is cool. Sometimes literally. Most times literally. Is this all? Yes, it is. Alright, let's move on over to the third stage, which I believe is the most annoying one. Yes, the outside stage, of course. There's floating platforms all around the place, and it just makes it miserable, so that's something to keep in mind. I'm personally not a fan of firefighters because I'm not very good with the physics in this game, so it's something that I'm not too big a fan of. You'll notice that at points, I will literally just run into the fire, just attempting to push it right into place. This is basically me using my Selkie as a scrubbing utensil for these lovely donut barrel things. Yeah, words are coming out of my mouth. They mean things. There we go, we got another one out. And as you can tell, you can also just use a single water thing on two fires, which is something I'm trying to do in order to conserve them. At certain later stages in the future, if you choose to play into this firefighter quest, these things get harder. And they will require you to use this two-in-one thing a lot more frequently. To the point where, at points, you're not allowed to fail whatsoever. So, that's something to keep in mind, that's the reason why I'm not into it. If you're really good at the physics in Ring of Fates, why not give this a go? And I don't think we have very much left. We got a floating platform in the middle of nowhere, a fire on a bridge. I'm a little bit confused about how this stuff managed to come be, but hey, don't worry about it. There we go, let's take care of you. And let's bowl you in. Strike! Actually, this is probably going to be more of a par, but nonetheless. There you go, that's one more fire to deal with. You are going to be annoying, though. Especially you, Goblin. I'm also talking about you, but... Alright, let's just... Eh. Oh, God. Yep. Bullet. Bullet good. We did it! Alright, quest complete. There we go. It's a lot better since we don't have a time limit. But Firefighters 2 is now available. We're almost running out of unique quests, and once we do, we'll probably just do a bunch of other random quests for fun, just for the sake of, you know, quest a day, talk to Kolka, because he's probably a lonely man sitting in his castle all day, got absolutely worthless jack stuff, so let's just move on from there, shall we? Oh, so much talking. I believe our final task of the day is to do our speedrun, so... hold your horses, cause ladies and gentlemen, Raylazor is about to show you the most wildest ride through the wildest forest in your life. Don't even know what kind of accent I was trying to feign. I think it was cowboy. Who cares? Let's go. Don't feel like fighting all these creatures anymore because it's wasting a bunch of time and we're sitting at an hour already. Gotta do these things quick, you know. I love how I said we were going to do that speed run in 10 to 15 minutes and I ended up doing literally anything else. I'm so sorry if I duped any viewers because of that. I am so sorry. My brain is... It's not registering thing. It's like, move left to right, shimmy, shimmy, don't make a scene. So there we go, let's get rid of this cobweb right away. And our basic goal right now is to just rush to the other side and get to the crossroads where we'll split off, do that thing that we needed to do, etc. Getting poisoned will slow you down quite a bit, so use your double jump wisely, and if you can't double jump, then unfortunately for you, you suck. You can actually hop on top of this platform right here in order to skip the bottom area. You cannot do that in story mode, which is a quick piece of trivia, so something to keep in mind. You can hop on the stump and just double jump up here if you don't feel like getting to that corner, which is all nasty and gross at points, and we'll be able to break this and move straight on ahead. Now, I am tempted to try to do that thingy where I'll land on the platform, and this makes no sense out of context, but I'll talk about it later, but we'll worry about that sooner or later. Let's just move on to the crossroads and go get that other umbrella palm tree yellow switch. That's a word. Another thing to keep in mind is that I'm not sure if you've noticed or not, but these speedruns still usually pertain to your permanent upgrades. You can still do a quick detour to go for that attack upgrade. The ones at Mount Val can still be detoured to in order to go for the permanent upgrades, like the 4 points of health and the 2 points of SP. So, just because it's a speedrun in which I'm just trying to get through it as fast as possible, you don't have to do the same thing. If you're looking for maxing out your stats, I'm just showing you what I believe to be the most efficient way of completing this game, or these levels. So, you can always do detours to do whatever you need to. Something to always keep in mind. I just dropped down, which is absolutely terrible for me, but that's okay because I can reroute myself by using one of those backtracky checkpoints, I believe. So, let's do that. Let's wait on this thing. So, I've already screwed up the speedrun, but it's okay, because I get to highlight the actual use of this thing right here. Not too bad, huh? Don't worry, I have this planned. But unfortunately, it means we're gonna have to wait for this platform to rotate around for a little bit longer. So just pretend I'm just really good and I'm already up ahead. Here, just blank out for the next minute, okay? Just do like a pause button, life continues. And then once you push your play button on life again, you'll be good to go, because Raylazor will seem like the most amazing speedrunner ever. When in reality, I've just played too much of this game. Alright, come on. Wait for it to completely, I don't know, stop moving? Stop shaking around? I don't know what word to say. Alright, we're going for the drop down thing. Where is this stupid platform? I'll get you this time, Gadget. Here we go! Yes! Perfect landing. Not actually very perfect. We could have fallen off very easily. But nonetheless, let's go. Yes, to the other platforms, we're going to hit that save crystal just for the sake of saving in case I die to the boss miserably. And otherwise, let's move on. Hit that platform and drop right on down. Nothing else to worry about, so let's move straight on to that other one. Yeah, you know exactly what that other one is. Okay, down here, let's go. And this is where I'm sure you people are very pleased to know you don't have invisible walls, and you can just double jump your way up here, skip all those silly detours that you don't need, it's okay. Coming up here is easy, and as you can tell right now, Abyssus Forest is not that long. I hope that if anyone's watching this because they're having a terrible time with Abyssus Forest, will actually have a much better time with the fact of how I clear out Abyssus Forest. I'm pretty sure I just said the name of this area like 20 times just then. Doesn't even matter. I find this the easiest route. It might not be the fastest route, but it's the easiest route in that it's memorable. You go one spot and then you head to the other one. What's so hard? Now, this dragoon lore thing is not very effective since I prefer my stomping attacks, but these mid-air attacks, as you can tell, do quite a bit of damage. I'm usually more into monk lore, which will allow my stomping attacks to do much more damage. Something to keep in mind, but I don't think that's going to be very effective. I'm also in the danger zone, so let's switch over to those Kira Magicites while I still can. Run away from that poison because I don't want to get hit, and it looks like I'm getting hit anyways and stunned, and I'm going to get double chain combo. This is terrible. Let's heal up before I get killed. Alright, let's hop right on onto the crystal and work on smashing this guy into bits because I really want to end this episode, get some water and cough drops. Come on, let's go, go, go. Alright, so far so good. Nothing too much to worry about. As you can tell, this boss is fairly easy. Clavats will have an easier time, so to say, because they can very easily destroy the buds, open up the mouth, and just, you know, smash it up with their crazy combo hits. Yukes don't have to worry too much because they get a duo attack and magic is always on your side. And Lotis, I presume, have it the roughest because, you know, they have slow one-hit attacks, they're gonna get poisoned and stunned so they might not always be able to attack as frequently. I'm sorry, Lotis, you're pretty much shafted in the Crystal Chronicles universe, at least for Ring of Fates. Anyways, we're almost done. My voice is almost ready to give in. But my character is not, and Selkie lands the final blow, destroys everyone, but the poison is still hanging around. And this is where she dies, the end, rip, terrible ending, blah blah blah. Unfortunately for me, in post I'm gonna have to do a lot of editing, and then I'm gonna have to probably run Abyssus Forest like 20 billion more times in order to get all the materials for each of the costume sets to show at the end of this video. So if you're into that, I encourage you highly to do so. Anyways, this video has been an hour 7 minutes long. Thank you for watching, and in the next one, we'll head on over to Raylazor. I will see you then.